the Pilot TV podcast this week. We are back saving the world with the Hargreaves clan in the Umbrella Academy Season 2, heading behind bars with Michael Sheen's serial killer in Prodigal Son, looking into a racially motivated murder in BBC One's Not a Film, Anthony, and welcoming back the Muppets as Kermit, Piggy, Fozzie, and the gang make their triumphant return on Disney+. I'm James Dyer, and welcome to the Pilot TV Podcast, your weekly guide to all the TV that matters, as long as they don't feature people baking on demand or watching telly in their living rooms. Joining me on the show, as we welcome Jim Henson's creations back to our screens, are Pilot's very own pair of Muppets. Boyd, who's your favourite Muppet?
Fozzie Bear.
Any particular reason? Is it the bow tie? Is it the hat?
Yeah, the whole look.
You dig his vibe.
I dig his vibe. I dig the fuzzy vibe, yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
It seems like a very benevolent character. I think when
he's the least twattish, I would say, all the Muppets.
Yeah.
So yeah, that's a good fit.
Yeah.
And before I ask this question, I almost certainly know where it's going. But Terry, which Muppet is your personal spirit animal?
Miss Piggy.
She's as ever surprising.
She's a bad bitch.
She is. I mean, she's a little bit obnoxious, don't you think?
Well, you know, if you were the only female Muppet and had to put up with male Muppets all day long, imagine being that woman, then maybe you'd be a bit of a bitch about it.
I must admit, it is pretty close to your general condition, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Is she a bit like Smurfette, like as the only... Are there any other women Muppets? There must be. Oh, yeah, there's the one. There's the hippie one that looks like a member of ABBA. I don't know what her name is.
There's basically Phoebe.
Is that her name?
Phoebe Buffay. She's Phoebe Buffay Muppet.
Oh, yes. Okay,
if Phoebe Buffay were a Muppet, that's the Muppet she'd be.
Yeah. With the fringe.
Yeah.
That one.
And the weird hat.
She has weird anatomically correct tonsils, which I find very disconcerting.
Wow, I wonder
where that was going.
Yeah. No, but like when she talks, they put an awful lot of detail into a sort of mouth topography. It's strange.
Mouth topography. That's a phrase I wasn't expecting.
What's
this early on.
What's the dangly thing at the back of your throat called?
Yeah, tonsils.
No, that's not a tonsil. The tonsils are the things on the side that they take out when you have tonsillitis. Like, what's the little dangly thing called? No one knows. Right, do you know what? I'm going to Google it. I want to know. Dangly thing at... back of mouth. There we go. What's it called? Uvula. That's it. An uvula.
Oh.
That's the thing. The little wobbly thing. That always, you know, like in Looney Tunes when they would scream and you'd see like little arms would come out and beat it like a chest. That thing.
Yeah.
But anyway, this Phoebe character has a very developed uvula.
Good.
Well, there you go.
Good. Glad we have established that.
It's what every girl wants, James, a well-developed uvula.
She's called Janice, that Muppet, I think.
Is it Janice?
Yeah.
I love that. She's called Janice, that Muppet. Is that like a character from a Guy Ritchie film?
Yeah, that Muppet.
Amazing, amazing. Right. Before we head into anything else, I believe it is time for the Queeby Challenge. So if any of you missed last week's podcast, you would have missed the fact that when we discovered that Queeby had in fact stealth launched, if you will, in the UK, that we would each of us download the Queeby app, exploit the free trial, and watch a show, or at least a small segment of a show. So guys, what was your Queeby experience like? Tell me, review Queeby for me. What did it do for you?
Right. So here's the good things, right? Incredibly easy to sign up. I hate sign up processes. They're the bane of my life. This, I literally obviously downloaded the app, put in my email, pressed my little buy button, and it was on my phone. It's incredible. Really easy to use. Wished everything was as easy as that. And I watched I watched Dummy, right? Which is the Cody Heller comedy that a lot has been talked about because it stars Anna Kendrick as somebody who essentially talks to her boyfriend's sex doll. And the sex doll comes to life. It's kind of like a fucked up mannequin. So imagine mannequin, right? But Andrew McCarthy has a real life girlfriend and the real life girlfriend ends up having this friendship with Kim Cattrall. If we were reviewing this, right, as normal telly, I hate to use that phrase, but if we were reviewing this as normal telly, I would be raving about this. The writing is incredible. It's so out there. There's a whole conversation about her boyfriend's sperm being stuck in the sex doll and how crusty it is and how she needs her to come and wash it out because otherwise he's going to be putting his dick in the pussy, they say over and over again, of the sex doll and then put it in her real life vagina and then she's going to get an infection. There's like a hot, it's so graphic. It's so out there. It's absolutely mad. The whole thing is completely surreal. It's like I'd slipped an acid or something. And I watched two by accident because it just keeps going. And you're like, oh, that was only 6 minutes. Great. I'll just watch another. But here's the problem. I still hate Nanad's coming out with it, but I really fucking hate watching it on my phone. I hate it. I hate it. I hate it. I hate it. I felt the entire time like I was being robbed of a real telly experience. And all I wanted to do was to watch it on a big telly. And I was like, can I plug my phone into the telly and put it on the telly and make it go bigger? Like, I cannot get over the experience of watching it on my phone. I hate it. I hate it. I hate it. And yet it is one of the funniest things I've seen in God knows how long. Anna Kendrick is amazing. The writing is genius. Like, Cody Heller should write all of the films and TV shows about women until the end of time. The woman is a genius. The idea is mental. But maybe that's the point, right? Is maybe Queeby is an opportunity to watch those shows that may not have got commissioned. I think this was originally a film and then was going to be another TV show. This could never exist on network TV. I'm not sure it could exist even, you know, on a Netflix. It's so out there. I struggle to see it on there. And maybe that's the point. Maybe it allows for more experimentation of content. And yet I'm like, I really want to watch the other episodes, but I really don't want to watch them on my phone. So I've been Googling, how do I watch Queeby not on the phone and put it on a telly? Which is the whole point of Queeby.
Were you not interested by the fact that, and I kept doing this, the way you can watch it in landscape or portrait, and it's perfectly framed in both. Yes. So I kept switching between them because like you go from your standard sort of 16:9 look in landscape. And then when you switch to portrait, they just zoom in on one person. And it's really tight and it's quite intimate. And even though I hated watching it on my phone, I found the portrait experience almost more interesting because it feels very personal and very in the face.
Yes.
And yeah, I it's weird, but yeah, I'm with you 100%. Like, I sat on the sofa and I watched it and I thought, I can do this because it's literally 7 minutes, but I can't imagine doing this long term. But I suppose it's designed for commuting, isn't it? It's not designed for sofa watching. You're supposed to be moving about, doing things on a bus. You've got 7 minutes between, you know, Angel and wherever it is your bus is going, and you want to watch an episode of sex doll drama.
Yeah, I can't get over the phone thing, but you are right, I have to say, in that I was watching it portrait and I was like, that looks like it's been shot for a phone. And I know obviously it must have been, but it partly looks like a home video and it looks like you're kind of spying on them almost. It's like the weirdest, most discombobulating thing, but it gives it a really different texture to telly. But you still know you're watching. I don't know. I can't explain it. It's trippy.
It feels like doing FaceTime with Anna Kendrick. Like, it's just a very strange experience. So I didn't watch Dummy. After all of my banging on about Dummy last week, I didn't actually watch it. I ended up watching Most Dangerous Game with Liam Hemsworth and Christoph Waltz. And again, so the basic premise of this is Liam Hemsworth is a guy who's dying of cancer and he needs some money for experimental treatment. Like, the plot in heavy air quotes is literally that. And so he goes to see Christoph Waltz, who I don't even know who he is. He's some kind of fixer for a loan. And Christoph Waltz says, no, I won't give you a loan, but tell you what, I will give your family millions if you allow my rich patrons to hunt you to death as Most Dangerous Games. It's like the backstory behind the John Woo movie, Hard Target. But it begins with Hemsworth in the office. So the thing with these, because they're in these little 7 minute chunks, like, there's no attempt at establishing shots or establishing context. They just drop you right into the thick of it. And it just kicks off from the minute, well, certainly with this one, it just went. So it starts with Hemsworth. He just, right, yeah, so you're dying, you're cancer, you need money. Yes, yes, yes. Well, I want people to hunt you with guns till you die, but we'll give your family loads of money. I'm going to call the cops. Are you, though? You said you'd do anything for your family. Would you really? I'll be out on the balcony having a cognac. Come and see me if you change your mind. And then he pulls acting conflicted face, and then he goes out and stands next to him, looks out over the city. He's like, tell me more. And that's the whole first episode of Most Dangerous Game. 7 minutes of drama packed into this tiny screen. And, I mean, I can almost imagine how this show plays out. I didn't watch a second episode because I just couldn't face it. But it was the format. I think it's like what we've been talking about. The format did fascinate me. I thought what they set out to do, which is objectively lunacy, but what they've set out to do, they've actually done very well. Like, they have genuinely created something that works on that format.
Yeah.
In terms of how long it is and in terms of how it's formatted for the screen. And the app works really well. As you said, it's really easy to sign up to. I don't mind it, but it's just not. It goes against everything in my DNA. The thought of like watching this like high, like, I don't want to see Christoph Waltz, you know, doing his best Blofeld at Liam Hemsworth on my phone, as lovely as my phone is. I want to see it on my TV. And it just, yeah, it doesn't do it for me. Boy, what was your show? What did you watch?
I watched 50 States of Fright.
You didn't watch Chrissy's Court?
No.
Oh, my God.
No. I mean, I was tempted. But 50 States of Fright is Sam Raimi's series, which is an anthology horror show in which every story is set in a different state, hence the title. And so there's, you know, there's one set in Kansas. The first one, the opening story is, this is the Golden Arm. So we talked about the Golden Arm
yes,
a bit.
Yes, yes, yes.
So the Golden Arm turns out to be part of 50 States of Fright. And the Golden Arm, the story of the Golden Arm, I shit you not, is that couple, Travis Fimmel and Rachel Brosnahan, lovely couple, kind of live in the woods somewhere in, well, in Michigan, in this state of Michigan. He decides he's going to chop down a massive tree in the woods nearby, and he decides that he's going to get his wife to, like, assist him in this, obviously, as you do. A gigantic, massive fucking tree in the forest. It goes hideously wrong. Spoiler alert. The tree lands on her arm. He has to amputate it with an axe. Now, I have to say, this is a weird week for me because, double spoiler alert, there's another show we're going to get to later on that has an amputation scene with an axe. I wasn't expecting two of those in the same week. And then this woman, Heather, played by Rachel Brosnahan, decides, fine, you've amputated my arm with an axe because you had to because the tree fell on it. But what I really need to happen now is I demand that you make an arm made of gold as a replacement limb, and it has to be gold. And the justification for her wanting this in the script is really early on in one of the scenes. She's described as a woman who wants everything, and she wants loads of stuff, and they can't afford it. It's really, I mean, the whole premise, by the way, is incredibly sexist.
I was going to say, that sounds like some nice casual misogyny.
It's unbelievably misogynistic, the whole thing. And then she proceeds to get this golden arm. And I'm not going to say any more. That's just the first episode. Then there's two more episodes of 6 minutes. It is extraordinary. It's played straight, by the way. It's not played for laughs. It's played deadly, deadly serious and horrific. And in fact, the scene of the tree falling on her is genuinely horrendous and awful and horrible and traumatic, the way it's done. Very skillfully done. Again, I agree with both of you, that the fascination of it is the aspect ratio thing. How did they make it? Like, I want to see the making of this show. I want to see how Sam Raimi, who directed it, you know, made sure that it works in the vertical, the extreme vertical version of the aspect ratio and the widescreen version, and that they both somehow work. It's extraordinary. How do you do the chopping down of a tree to fall on an arm? And, you know, in both of those ways, it's fascinating. But the show itself is just absolutely insane. And there's a bit when she gets the golden arm where this little girl bumps into her and goes, "Are you a princess?" And she goes, "No, I've just got a golden arm." And it is one of the most bizarre, demented things I've ever seen. And I'm not exaggerating. But it's kind of well done within the confines. You know, it's Sam Raimi. He knows what he's doing. So it's kind of really well directed. The production values are high. Rachel Brosnahan is taking it very seriously. And I really want to see the making of this thing. How did they all decide to take it so seriously? How did they decide this idea was in any way valid and that it wasn't completely fucking nuts and should never have been made?
Isn't the problem that it's not sustainable, right? So I'm sure we'll come to it in news, and there's been another show announced this week with, I'll just say it now, fuck it. So for the Mucker, which is Ryan Reynolds and Samuel L. Jackson animated series, and every, you know, I think it was actually in the Empire article, and it said, Creeby's been quite disappointing in terms of sign up, so they're really throwing star power at it and these big names. But that's what they've been doing since the beginning, and isn't the problem that, you know, you have to get the world's greatest directors, the world's greatest actors, because the form of it and your very basic proposition people aren't on board with, and this is a mass generalization, which is, I think, a lot of people who love proper cinematic telly find it difficult to imagine watching on a phone. And obviously you've got the short kind of episode length, and they are fundamental to the heart of Queeby and what it is. So how many years can you just keep, like, spending millions and millions on the world's most phenomenal directors and the buzziest actors to kind of paper over the fact that the very thing you're offering is really hard for people to accept. And how sustainable does that make it?
Completely. And also, by the way, I think that also stretches to the premises, so to speak, of the shows. That's why you're creating the one you want, the blow up doll idea, and this one, the golden arm idea, they're so bizarre and extreme. And I think, again, they feel they have to be, the scripted stuff particularly, has to be this bizarre and extreme to be that eye catching that people will want to watch it and put up with the fact that it is weird and irritating to have to watch it on your fucking phone in the first place. By the way, what I wanted to say about the whole, because when we talked about it, the whole reason we're doing this reviewing these different episodes is because people pointed out to us on social media that it was available in this country, but it still was never officially launched, right? So what happened was Quibi was launched with a big fanfare in America, huge big launch, you know, critics sent out things to review, given free passes for it, etc., etc., etc. It was a disaster pretty much, you know, from the off, more or less. It immediately plummeted down the app chart, as we said. And I think the Quibi people just thought they were going to have major proper launches in Europe and the rest of the world. I think they just thought, fuck it, we'll just make it available. So there is no content made for outside of America, by the way. So Nish Kumar's done a show for it, but that's for the American market. It's Nish Kumar using his satirical comedy about America. So there's no original content from this country yet. And I don't know if they're ever going to launch it properly in this country, and yet you can pay for it in English pounds and watch it, as we've done, quite easily, as we've all said. But it's still never officially been properly launched.
The question's got to be how much longer it will just last, isn't it? Because at some point, they're just going to run out of money because no one's really subscribing to it.
But they are very rich people that backed it, and they are still announcing new, as you say, new projects. It is weird. It's bizarre. I think they're hoping that once the pandemic goes away, that was magically everyone will suddenly go, oh, yeah, this is what I want to watch. Went on the commute, because no one's commuting, are they? That's a fucking problem for them.
It is. I mean, of all the things, it is the most disastrous thing that could happen to them.
Exactly. So I would possibly just about maybe watch something on a commute, like maybe a more factual thing. Like there's some quite interesting factual shows on it. There's like a cookery show that someone recommended to us on Twitter. But I don't think I'm ever going to want to watch one of these high production value scripted quite good shows on the fucking phone.
What happened to the one that Terry was going to watch under a duvet? Like, did that ever come off in the end?
That was a Spielberg horror film, wasn't it?
That's right, yeah.
You can only watch at night, and I was convinced it was. It was like, how will they know? Will they check the light? And you're like, the location settings in your phone? The time, the clock.
Quibi then. So, you know, it is available now on whatever app store services your particular device. And, you know, if anyone does find a way to broadcast it to their telly, let us know. Let us move on now to what we've been watching that isn't on Quibi. So what have you been watching in your actual tellies this week?
Well, I tuned in yesterday, recording this on Friday, to Loose Women on ITV, and I watched Terry White talking about her extraordinary book, and that was amazing. And I did mention it to you on our WhatsApp group.
You did?
And of course, you genuinely, listeners, James Dyer, right? Our colleague, our much loved colleague and leader, Terry, was on Loose Women yesterday, which is a huge thing. Loose Women is an iconic show on ITV. And James genuinely had no fucking idea how to watch it or what it was or where to go or anything.
Though I will say that not only did you mention it on the WhatsApp group, my mum then phoned me to say, Terry's on Loose Women. I was like, this is not helpful.
Oh my God. I know. It was like, what is the daytime television you speak of? Like, what is this thing? The
what
remote
is this?
Control.
I've heard of Days of Our Lives. Is it that?
Anyway, those of us who knew what it was and watched it on ITV, it was fantastic. So that was great. That was the TV highlight of the week. But the other thing I wanted to mention is last week I mentioned the Murdoch documentary series, which is still phenomenal. Episode 2 went out this week, and the third one is on next Tuesday. The other incredible documentary series that's going on at the moment on BBC Two is Once Upon a Time in Iraq. I don't know if either of you have seen any of it. Well, James definitely hasn't seen any of it. It's fucking grim, I warn you now, but it is phenomenal. It's brilliant. And what it is it's a look at the Iraq war from the point of view. No politicians are in it. So all the talking heads, all the people reminiscing about the Iraq war and explaining what actually happened, the people actually affected by it. So citizens, you get army generals. There's an army general, American army general, who starts out being incredibly decent to the Iraqis when after the war, and they're trying to do the reconstruction. And he's furious with what the politicians are doing because they don't know what the fuck they're doing, the American politicians. And he takes it upon himself to kind of befriend locals. He meets local religious leaders. He meets the various representatives of different factions in Iraq in the incredibly complicated factional world that it is. But then as time goes on, and as there's a kind of insurrection in Iraq, and as the locals rebel against the American authorities, and it gets really scary and dangerous, he kind of goes loopy, and he kind of does a General Kurtz from Apocalypse Now. And it's fascinating to watch him kind of explaining himself and other people who met him and knew him and knew his story talking about what happened to him. And then there's a young translator who was a teenager at the time when the Iraq war, a local who helped all the TV journalists with their translation. He's incredibly charismatic and funny and engaging. There's a woman in the episode, like in episode two, who was affected by shrapnel, which flew into her face, and her story is unbelievably moving and bleak and desperate. But overall, it just shows you the incredible stark reality of war, and of this war in particular, on the people affected by it. It is unrelentingly brilliant and fascinating, and it's one of the most powerful things I've seen in a long time.
Carrie, what have you been watching?
So actually, on Boyd's recommendation, I watched the Murdoch Dynasty documentary on iPlayer, which, as he said, the second episode aired. And I always, you know, wondered if I'm really interested in the inner workings of media and politics and the intersection of the two, and thought, you know, is this just going to be something that appeals to people like us? But it is so brilliantly done. The first episode, as Boyd outlined last week, looks at, you know, the family setup, the closeness in politics, particularly around the time of New Labour, their kind of Murdoch's role in Tony Blair coming into power. And it kind of set up the premise of all the complicated dynamics of modern politics and Murdoch, and also within his family. Episode two, which is called The Rebel Alliance, James, just for you,
yes.
Which is basically Levinson phone hacking, News the World closing, kind of the dynamic when the family, within the siblings, when this is happening. This documentary is so brilliantly done, and it's weird because you think you know about all of these moments because they all happen so publicly, but it gives such amazing texture and context. I just think it's actually one of the best documentaries like this I've seen in years. It's absolutely exquisitely done. If you haven't seen it, the first two episodes are on iPlayer, and the third one will be dropping. Is it three episodes?
Yeah.
Watch it. Even if you think you've got no interest in media or anything like that, it is just brilliant. So that is what I've been watching this week.
Well, I was inspired by, we talked about this, we kind of mentioned it in dispatches, we didn't review it, that season three of Absentia kind of dropped on Amazon. And that had been on my watch list for a while. So I thought, well, since season three stopped, I'll go back and watch that. So I watched the whole of season one of Absentia, and I'm now halfway through season two. And I've been basically binging it all week. So this is Stena Katic, I think that's how you pronounce her name, but she was famous. She was in Castle with Nathan Fillion. And she plays an FBI agent called Emily Byrne, who is quote-unquote murdered by a serial killer at the beginning, and obviously life moves on. And then 6 years later, it turns out she wasn't murdered at all. She's just been essentially kidnapped and imprisoned and drowned in a tank repeatedly. And so she's rescued, and her husband, who is also an FBI agent, he has remarried, and the son, who was like three, is now 6 years older and barely remembers her. And so she comes back to this life she left after having been abducted for 6 years and being horribly traumatized. And then, of course, there's lots of things happen. She gets framed for all sorts of things. She goes on the run. She becomes a fugitive. It is one of the most ridiculous things you will ever watch. And it's very trashy, but it's really good. Like, it's incredibly compelling. And I will say, I don't recall watching a show that has gripped me as much as this in quite a long time, in that I can't stop watching it. Like, you watch one and before you know it, you've watched four and it's 2 o'clock in the morning. And you're like, I just want to watch one more. Then I go to bed. Just one more. Oh, it's the finale. I've got to watch the finale. And then it's like morning. Like, so I really have been watching this ridiculous amount. The season two is less focused because I think season one had a very clever setup, clever premise, and season two it's a different story, but it's still good. So I'm pressing on with this as well. So that is Absentia, which is available on Amazon Prime. If you have that, I do recommend it. Right, shall we now address a listener question? And this week's listener question comes from Ryan. And Ryan says, has there ever been a word or catchphrase from a television show that became part of your daily vernacular? Terry. I don't know why I didn't see that coming, and I feel I kind of should.
I mean, look, daily vernacular might be a push. I don't know. But you know, several times a week vernacular. I definitely say that. I find myself saying a lot of friends quotes. So I have my best friend. Whenever we're emotional, we just send each other, Mrs. Geller, why are you crying? From when Rachel comes back from Emily and Ross's honeymoon in Greece. There's actually a lot of ones from friends.
I think we all do that. I do loads of friends ones. Yep. No, see, the funny, the is it though thing is, for me, that's always Thor from Thor Ragnarok. Is it though? That's where I get that one from. But yes, you're right. There is a version of that. Yeah. But there are so many, like the Chandlerisms. I think loads of people drop Chandlerisms.
Could I be wearing any more clothes? Exactly. And it doesn't even make sense in any context, but it's just you say it and you understand what it means.
And that's a Joeyism.
Yeah.
Oh, yes. Friends is great.
I thought that was a Joey doing Joey a Chandler. Doing Chandler.
It was a Joeyism doing a Chandlerism. Yes. Friends, I think, has probably, I would say, lent more to popular culture than the majority of other TV shows. It's just extraordinary how much. Mm. And it's amazing how, like, kids now are just discovering it. And, like, I saw a kid recently, like, must have been, what, 5 or 6, wearing a T-shirt which had, like, Monica and Chandler and Joey and Phoebe and Reggie. It had all of the characters. I was like, you can't possibly know what that is. Why are you wearing it?
Oh my God, that's weird.
It's never ending. It is never ending. So is there anything else? Anything else? You don't find yourself quoting SVU to people?
No, I mean, no. I do chung chung a lot, which is more of a sound effect.
Yes.
But you say chung chung to anybody and they know exactly what it is.
All right. Boy, it's like you don't strike me as someone who regularly drops the quotes into your everyday speech. You're more original than that.
Oh, thanks. But as per last week when we were doing which fictional character we should be, and I was Larry David from Curb Your Enthusiasm. Most of mine are from Curb Your Enthusiasm or Seinfeld. So Seinfeld, yada, 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 became an actual... That did become a proper pop cultural phenomenon where people started saying yada, yada, yada. And still now... And now people say yada, yada, yada to mean, you know, to fill in. And they're like... I mean, in the show, famously, they do yada, yada, yada on a date. And Elaine says, I took him back to mine. We had coffee and yada, yada, yada. We woke up the next morning. But now people say it. I hear people saying yada, yada, and they have no idea where the fuck it came from.
It's here. I've said that and I didn't know it was from Seinfeld.
Absolutely originates from Seinfeld. And the episode, I think, is even called the yada, yada. But Seinfeld itself had loads of kind of iconic phrases and sayings that have become used quite a lot. And then, of course, like, you know, Master of My Domain, all of that from the episode. King of the County, etc. But then in Curb, the one in Curb that was really punched through, I think, to general, for me anyway, is pretty, pretty, pretty good, which he used. Pretty, pretty, pretty. So I do find myself saying that a lot to an almost obnoxious degree. And then he also kind of, one of my favorite scenes of all time in Curb is when he goes into a Starbucks basically and gets infuriated and points out the insanity of coffee in Starbucks. And, you know, he asks for some vanilla bullshit thing from the barista. And then the barista gets annoyed with him for not specifying. And then he basically says, milk and coffee and milk together. Who'd have thought? And then he just does this whole bit about how ludicrous coffee is in all its very forms. forms in a Starbucks, which is hilarious. And I really love, in what I do find myself in tweets often trying to ape the device that David Brent used in the classic episode of The Office, where he says, he talks about his heroes in life and he goes, Milligan, Cleese, Everett, Sessions, which is one of the great quotes of all time. And I often find myself aping that device in a tweet. So, I'll, you know, I don't know, talking about leaders of the world or whatever, or things, just listing them in that way with the final Sessions, I think is very influential. They're mine, yeah.
Oh, God. I mean, I use quite a few West Wing ones, like What's Next, which is a famous West Wing sort of like mover honor type thing that Bartlett does. I've used a number of times. Also, the slightly more obnoxious ones. I remember coming to the office once and declaring that I drank from the keg of glory. Bring me the finest muffins and bagels in all the land. I've never cursed God out in Latin, though that's probably on my bucket list somewhere. But like when I was growing up, it was very much like Red Dwarf. I used to like occasionally lapse into sort of some pseudo Scouse accent while trying to quote Dave Lister as a teenager, which is
absolutely not.
That's not going to happen. Blackadderisms, I think, were a solid part of my teenage years as well. Like, I used to do a lot of those. I mean, Terry, yeah. I can barely count the times I come into the office and said, Terry, does it all have to end this way? Our valued friendship ending with me cutting you into strips and telling the prince that you walked over a very sharp cattle grid in an extremely heavy hat.
I just call that Monday.
Yeah. I thought you were going to say cunning plan. Yeah, because cunning plan has become a prop. That's a proper phrase.
Is it so cunning? It's just been appointed professor of cunning at Oxford University. Yes, a lot of that. A lot of that.
Why are you all of yours so like slog up onto your mansplaining?
But I wonder.
But this is shock horror.
This is a chicken and egg thing. Like, what came first, the smug twat or the stuff that featured smug twats? Did they make me a smug twat, or was I a smug twat and therefore I was attracted to it?
You were a smug twat. Like, let's not blame television for you being a smug twat.
Like, I don't know. We could blame Aaron Sorkin, I think. I quite like that.
You think that? Yeah, it's Sorkin's fault. Sorkin and Ben Elton have done this to me. Yeah, like Fawlty Towers was another one. I used to quite a lot of Fawlty Towers as a kid. Not so much now on account of it being wildly problematic, but, you know, certainly I enjoyed that as a kid.
Only one episode is wildly problematic.
Well, yeah, I mean, yes, you're right. It is mainly that. Although I would argue there are other parts in there which are a little bit tricky, but that particular one is the worst offender. But yeah, but it is films. Like, and anyone who comes into the Empire office will know this, that like we quote things endlessly. Like, we communicate almost exclusively in diehard quotes on some days. Like, it's just, it is almost parody. So yes, I would say so many catchphrases from TV, from film and stuff do sort of seep into our sort of collective consciousness. Weirdly, sometimes I find it strange where when you've worked, because I've been at Empire a very long time, and when you've worked with people for so long and you have this sort of shorthand based on this sort of shared love of a thing, and you use it so much to communicate with each other, then you speak to other people, like my friends from outside of work, and I'll say something and they'll just look at me entirely blankly, and I'll realize that I've either quoted something or referenced something that they just have no idea what I'm talking about, and I feel like they just don't really hear me.
I mean, I'm not saying that some men use quotes from films to speak to each other because they're not always capable of having a true and genuine conversation. But I would say that that applies to certain moments in the Empire office, having sat there and endured it for 5 long years. I'll tell you what, though, I always think it's harder these days for it to cut through because there are so many shows, and it isn't like when we were a little bit younger where something was cult and everybody was watching at the same time and talking about it. But I think Fleabag did that actually in real time, and it was one of the few ones recently. You know, like, all the women I knew were all like sending each other gifts or saying to each other, hair is everything, Anthony, and just stuff like that became instantly iconic. And really what we're talking about, and to your point about Aaron Sorkin, you're talking about writers who understand what will stay with people and what will kind of come to symbolize something in popular culture itself outside of the show.
But you're quite right that it has almost transitioned where people used to quote things to each other, and whereas now people use GIFs to do much the same thing. So the GIF communication is off the chain. I mean, I'm massively guilty of this. I love a good GIF. Like, why use actual words when you can communicate in a GIF? That's how I stand. Yeah. I'd do this whole podcast in GIFs if I was able to do it.
Use your words, James. Words are there. Language is great.
What you should do, like when you meet a new person, you should ask to see their sort of GIFy homepage, which shows their most used GIFs, and that'll probably tell you a lot about that person.
Oh, I'd love to see your yours.
Yeah, yours would be fascinating.
Can you imagine?
Regarding is it though, which has become so pervasive, it's like I feel like sometimes the Empire podcast, which you're also on every week, is sometimes literally just you and Chris Hewitt going, is it though, to each other for about 2 hours.
There was a point, actually, this is absolutely true, where Chris said, look, I think we should impose a ban on is it though on the podcast. I think it's driving people nuts. And I was like, but absolutely not.
Yeah.
I mean, what can I say for 90 minutes?
Yeah, exactly. We did retire, where's the handle? The kind of quote of Atri from Infinity War, because that, I think, started to stretch beyond parody. But yeah, it is one of the many reasons that Chris and I are completely insufferable.
Yeah. Maybe.
Oh, good times. Well, Ryan,
slightly to why you and Chris Hewitt are irritating.
Well, we've just come full circle to smug twats, haven't we? So actually, it's all perfect. Ryan, yes, that was your question. I hope that helped. If you'd like your question answered, feel free to chuck it to me on social media, on Instagram or Twitter at James C. Dyer, and I will attempt to deal with it there. Right, let us move on now to this week's news. And I'm going to kick off with an exclusive that I discovered on the internet. So this exclusive story comes via Deadline.com. And it mentions that producer Bad Wolf Options... Terry White. Yes, Terry White of Empire Magazine. His memoir, not an autobiography, a memoir, has been picked up by Bad Wolf, who did His Dark Materials, who did... Discovery of Witches. Come on. I mean, you'll never top that. Let's be honest. That's always going to be the centerpiece of their slate, and you just need to be comfortable with that. Didn't they have something to do with Doctor Who as well?
No. Wolf was a phrase in Doctor Who that I believe.
And a place.
Yeah.
Bad Wolf
and
Bay.
And a place.
Yeah. And it's simple. Yeah. That's a whole. Don't get me on Bad Wolf.
Let's not get
onto
Bad Wolf and Doctor Who. Right. Okay. Well, anyway. So, and they have bought the rights to your memoir, which is now a thing that's going to happen. And obviously, we know this because we saw the exclusive on Deadline. com, a website that you'll be surprised here is not the Empire website. So that was interesting. It's good. They must have connections. They must have an in somehow, perhaps, with the writer, you know, which got them this scoop.
Well, look, you know, here's the thing. This has been in the works for some time. Lovely, really exciting thing. And they said, oh, we're going to send out a press release. And I was like, who the fuck's going to care? Like, about who's really going to give a shit? And I thought, oh, it's really nice of them to send a press release out. Nobody's going to pick it up because who am I? And so, and then it ended up being picked up by Deadline and Variety. And they ran stories. And then Ben Travis just kind of sent me loads of question marks going, like, what the fuck is happening?
Judas.
It never occurred to me because, you know, they've optioned the book. It's really exciting, but we haven't started talking about casting or anything yet. Well, we kind of have secretly, but not, you know, properly. So it's not like there's a famous actor attached or a great showrunner. So you were as surprised as I was, to be honest. But yeah.
Let's talk casting for a moment. So Mariska Hargitay, have you spoken to her? Have you sent the feelers out?
Well, here's the thing, James. This book is set in my childhood and in my early 30s.
She's very versatile.
Mariska, to be honest, is looking good on 50, whatever she is. But you know, that it might not quite work out. But I could create a role for Mariska. Like, she could be like the psychiatrist or, you know, one of the people in the psychiatric ward.
You will be perhaps unsurprised to hear that the topic of casting this particular property did come up on the Empire podcast, and I took some notes so that we could share with you what people thought as the young Terry White. I will not be crediting any of these suggestions for the benefit of safeguarding people's jobs. So first of all, one of our number suggested Vicky McClure as Terry White, which I actually thought was not Midlander, Midlander.
She is.
Yeah, so I thought she'd be a good choice. Someone else suggested Billy Piper. I'm not entirely sure why, but they did. So I could see that happening. Gemma Arterton and Ruth Wilson were also mooted as possible Terrys. My suggestion of Lauren Socha fell on deaf ears, but I still maintain that nothing can be... I think young Terry, absolutely Lauren Socha. Comedy Lauren Socha as you.
What, me at like 7?
I mean, no, all Lauren ages. All, as I say, she's an actress without peer. I think you, from 7 to your current age, all the way through her, which is a variety of different perms. I think that's the way to go.
Oh my God. I mean, you could feasibly play me just the only thing that changes is the hair. So it's perm and then it's weird. There's a family living in it, beehive. Yeah. I don't disagree with Lauren Socher, I have to say. She's incredible.
I think Arterton was suggested because she can definitely pull off a beehive and has done in the past. So perhaps that's why.
I appreciate that these are the important things.
They are.
So Gemma Arterton for her hair.
Yes.
Lauren Socher, presumably, for she could pull off a perm. I think they're all fine suggestions.
Boyd, who would you cast?
Well, I don't know if I'm still watching National Treasure, which has been repeated on Channel 4. And Andrea Riseborough is fucking brilliant in that. She is my number one choice because I think she excels at playing. And let's face it, in this particular story, it's about a troubled young woman, and she's fucking brilliant at that. So yeah, Andrea Riseborough is my pick.
Okay.
Troubled young woman.
Indeed. Yeah. Well, if you want any more information on this, you'll find the exclusive story on deadline.com, so you can read all about it there. Any other news that we haven't been scooped on?
I talked about Father Mucker, obviously, earlier in the podcast. So this is the Ryan Reynolds and Samuel L. Jackson animated series. Mm. Obviously, they've been on screen together before. In Hitman's Bodyguard, I think they've either made or are making the sequel to that. And it's from the writers of Blockers, which actually got me excited because I still maintain that Blockers is a massively underrated film, which made me laugh more than pretty much any other film the year it came out. And it's the writers of that who are writing this and are going to be showrunners. I think this could be amazing because I actually think the chemistry between Ryan Reynolds, I understand it's animated, but the chemistry between Ryan Reynolds and Samuel L. Jackson, I think is lovely. And I think they are fucking fantastic together. I didn't think The Hitman's Bodyguard was the best film I'd ever seen by any stretch, but they have a brilliant dynamic. And with those kind of writers attached and just being called for the mucker, which made me laugh hysterically this morning at 5 a.m, is enough for me. But again, you know, it's on Quibi, all of the things we've talked about with Quibi. Animation on there would be another entirely different thing, I'm sure. So no kind of date on that, that's just been announced as kind of being greenlit.
I've got more news about Bad Wolf, the production company behind the adaptation of Terry White's book, which is that his Dark Materials series 2 has been confirmed for the autumn on BBC One. And I find it quite surprising because it seems like barely a year since series 1 went out. And I don't know whether they filmed it simultaneously but you know, to have such a huge, big, epic production ready for the second series so quickly, not affected at all by the pandemic or anything, etc. And the very exciting news has also revealed that the voice of the demon of Andrew Scott's character, Colonel John Parry, will be played by Phoebe Waller-Bridge.
Yeah, I saw that.
Incredible.
Is a fantastic,
also,
brilliant
season
thing.
2 is going to be -1 episode as well. They've had to cut one episode, which was an original one, which focused on James McAvoy's character, who I don't think was going to really be in it otherwise. But they just weren't, because of the pandemic, they weren't able to film it. So
it has been affected by the pandemic.
Yeah.
And Terrence Stamp, right? He's been announced as joining the cast. And we probably should say that this was part of Comic-Con at Home. And there's quite a bit of news out of that, obviously. Comic-Con would normally be happening in San Diego. It isn't, for all the obvious reasons. And so it's been done virtually, including a panel hosted by Chris Hewitt that I was reading about, which was Truth Seekers. This is the supernatural horror comedy series with Simon Pegg and Nick Frost, which they co-wrote with Nat Saunders, James Serafinowicz, directed by Jim Field Smith. And it's these team of paranormal investigators who are filming kind of ghost sightings across the UK and putting them on an online channel for the world to see. And this is going to be an Amazon Prime Video show, I believe.
Yeah, and I thought the trailer looked really good, actually.
Yeah, it looked funny.
Yeah, really funny, really well done.
What else has come out? Neil Gaiman spoke about Sandman briefly, which is very exciting. I don't know if anyone noticed, if you're upset that Sandman, which is supposed to start shooting in May, has sort of been delayed. The audiobooks, Audible have released massively star-studded audiobooks of the first three books of Sandman, which has got like Kat Dennings in there and James McAvoy and all sorts of people. That's well worth checking out. But Gaiman was talking about the actual show and that it is going to be set in 2021. When it actually comes out. So Morpheus will have been kept prisoner in a jar for 105 years instead of the 70 of the original graphic novel. So I can tell that Terry's fascinated by that particular turn of events. But
I was like, when you said that, like, you was like, so like, oh, an extra 70 years, not just a bloody years. Like, so excited. Oh.
I love Sam, man. It's great. This is good news. Yeah. All right, fine.
Yeah.
Perry Mason has been renewed for a second season. There you go. That's exciting.
Yeah. The Boys has been renewed for a third season.
Yes. Looking forward to season two. Lando. Have you heard of the Lando? It's only a rumor at this stage. Yeah. There's a rumor that Donald Glover might return to play Lando in a Disney Plus TV series. So whether or not we ever see that remains to be seen.
I mean, it makes total sense.
It does make sense.
Because they literally dropped him in to that film and it was clear, like, oh, now we can do something with this character.
Yeah, it's funny because there's certainly a contingent that's very much like Solo's best forgotten. But he was a lot of fun in it. I mean, he was arguably the best thing in the film. So
yeah. The BAFTAs take place, the TV BAFTAs take place on Friday, this Friday, as we're going out now on Monday. So Friday 31st on BBC One at 7 o'clock. And it's been announced that Idris Elba is getting a special award, the kind of prestigious person who deserves an award, almost like the equivalent of a lifetime achievement thing. And it's recognising not only his career on TV, but also his commitment to championing diversity and new talent. And I think that would be a kind of lovely moment for him.
That's brilliant.
Yeah.
Any other news? Is that the end of news?
I'm quite excited about the show Roadkill. BBC put out a picture of Hugh Laurie from Roadkill. Have you heard about this? It's a political thriller written by David Hare, who's obviously a legendary playwright. Just the cast. He plays a politician whose public and private life is falling apart, and there's a conspiracy. I love conspiracy political thriller type things. Helen McCroy is in it. Sid Sababic Knudsen's in it from Westworld. Sarah Green from Dublin Murders is in it, and Normal People. It's just got a brilliant cast and a great writer, so I'm excited about that. We should be arriving in the autumn as well.
Right. Well, if that is all the current affairs we have for you today, Terry, any other massive exclusive you ceded to other outlets that maybe you could share with us now? No? Okay.
You can have first dibs on the casting, James.
Thank you. Right. Let's move on to this week's reviews. And first up, we have season two of Netflix's The Umbrella Academy, which reunites us with numbers 1 through 7, picking up after season one's dramatic finale, which saw them all flung into the void as number 5 tried to save them from the apocalypse. Terry, was this a number 1 or a number 2?
Oh my God.
Wow.
It writes itself, doesn't it? So this has been a long time in the making when it comes to season two. And, you know, we loved this, if I remember rightly.
As I recall, I liked it. Boyd didn't like it. And you were wildly met about it.
What's that? I was trying to remember how I felt before. I do know that I didn't carry on watching it.
Yeah.
That is what I know. But it was a massive hit, right? So I think it was Netflix's third biggest TV show that year. They put out a figure of it had been watched by 45 million households. And as we know, this was based on the comic book series by Gerard Way and Gabriel Barr. And I do remember there was loads of buzz about it, but it's been so long, like, what, 2 years, I want to say, since...
It's actually only been a year, like, less than 18 months, because it went out February.
You expect it to come back...
It's been slightly over a year.
Sorry.
So it's been slightly over a year, not that long, some may say, since... and I'll tell you what, this first, and I do remember us discussing this when it came to the first season, which is this is such incredibly well done television. Let's just say that from the get go. So where this picks up on season 2, episode 1, if you haven't watched the end of season 1 and you want to keep watching it before you watch this, then I would suggest skipping past this part of the review, because obviously it's going to cover off where we pick up. And it immediately opens in the 1960s, and each of them have been dropped in slightly different parts of Dallas in slightly different years in the 1960s. It's just before the Kennedy assassination. And there's a new apocalypse, because presumably there's always going to be a new apocalypse. And at the point we kind of join them, there's 10 days for him to find everybody, bring them back together and save the world in a nutshell. And you do forget, I forgot how exquisitely this is done, whether it's the effects, the soundtrack is incredible. Like, it is such brilliantly, brilliantly done telly. I mean, the cast is just incredible, right? So Ellen Page for me is still one of the standouts of this. She is brilliant in this. And what's really interesting is they are kind of in these different years in Dallas, just before this big kind of significant moment in history. But interestingly, some of the group have been there for longer than others, and some have been stuck for years. And so they've developed these incredible new lives. So Allison's involved in the civil rights movement. Diego's in a psychiatric ward, which is incredible. And there's this amazing scene where they're discussing his hero complex, which is just like brilliantly done. But there are, and because of this setting where they have developed these kind of independent lives, there's some brilliant additions to the cast this time around. So you've got Ritu Arya, who we know from Humans, obviously. She is brilliant in this. She is there in the psychiatric ward. And I have to say, like, she is spectacular, a wonderful addition. Yusuf Gatewood, who's Alison's husband, and Marin Island, who essentially plays this kind of surrogate mother figure to Ellen Page's character. I only watched the first episode of season two, but it made me regret not continuing with season one. And as I say, it's just in the hour, the amount of ground they covered, the brilliant way they do characterization, these little vignettes, they move between the characters and you fall back in love with these characters and this kind of alternate normal life they could have had. And yet there's still loads of action. As I say, this impending apocalypse, battle scenes. I really loved this first episode, and I'm definitely going to continue watching. But just this, the skill and the craft in this show, it is really, really excellently done.
It's more accessible in some ways. So season one takes a little while to build up momentum because it starts with that funeral episode. Their father's died, that brings them all together, and it sets up the idea of the apocalypse. And that plays out over those 10 episodes. But it takes a little while to get onto its feet. It's also a funny one because it's very stylistic. It's got a really interesting tone to it. It's not like one of these sort of Nolanized superhero shows. And it's not even like The Boys, which just feels very tongue-in-cheek and self-referential. It takes place in a very heightened reality. But it also comes very close to failing the Bellend test for me. So I like this despite the fact that all the characters are kind of Bellends, but they're mild Bellends. Like it's a sort of a genteel Bellendery kind of permeates this sort of whole show where they're all quite irritating in their own way, but there's something lovable about them as well. So number five in particular is smug as fuck and deeply annoying, you know. And
he reminds me of you.
I knew you'd say that.
He really reminds me of you.
I have the awareness to realize that. And yet you kind of go with him because he's quite funny regardless. So I quite like him as well. And I like what they did. They timelined hop a lot in season one. We used to see them all as kids and then you saw them as adults. So it showed their formative years. Don't know if they've left that behind, but I feel like there's a lot more on the table this time with the new setting, the fact that that they're all separated because they end the first season fleeing the apocalypse and then end up in the 1960s. But I'm fascinated to see where this goes and where there's a sort of triad of albino hitmen in this. You're not quite sure who they are or where they're from, but there's this temporal police squad in season one, which is Mary J. Blige is sort of a hitman for them, the two hitmen, Cha-Cha and Hazel. So you got to wonder if they're going to be involved in this as well. Lots happening. I've never read the graphic novel, so I genuinely don't know where this is going. But yeah, I watched season one over the last couple of weeks and really, really enjoyed it. So definitely want to press on with this. Boyd, you were the most naysaying about season one, as I recall. Is that persisting?
Yeah. I mean, there is a lot happening. In the opening scene, there's like fucking Russians invading Texas. Yep. There's like all the characters drop from the sky and have their own fights and counter spectacular like action sequence, which ends in a fucking nuclear explosion. Yeah.
It's like the beginning of Age of Ultron.
Yeah, after that I was like, yeah, but you know, come on, give us some incident, give us some action, you know. It's a relentlessly, what my issue with it is, and I still have the same problems to some extent I had with series one, is that it's got that tone that reminds me a little bit of a Zack Snyder film, you know, particularly Watchmen. His version of Watchmen, if you remember, has loads of these sequences like slow motion with the brilliant songs and, you know, and that thing has become a bit of a cliche where you have a big slow motion action montage with a slightly weirdly inappropriate song going on, I don't know, by Frank Sinatra or someone. And I find that whole tone slightly arch and knowing, and that's my issue with it. But having said that, it's incredibly watchable, you know, because the cast is brilliant. I agree with all of that. You know, I find Actually, my least favorite character is Robert Sheehan's character. He is an even bigger Bellend.
He's the biggest of the
Bellends.
He's so irritating. Yes, he is King Bellend.
He's the biggest of the Bellends, yeah. And I find him just a bit much to deal with. And I find the whole thing a bit much, you know, at various moments in it. And I still think that. I watched two episodes and I'm like, just calm down a bit. Like, not everything has to be, you know, it's almost like we can do anything we want in this show now. You know, we've got a fucking massive budget from Netflix. We can do whatever effects we want. We're going to have the nuclear explosion in the first 10 seconds. But I just wish it would just calm down a bit and give me a bit more of, you know, I want to see a bit more of Ellen Page's character, you know. And it has to cut between, what, 7 different characters, really? I found it all a bit much, to be honest. And when it calms down and is just, you know, and concentrates on the characters and their stories, it's good. It's really good. It has really good moments. But I just think it's a bit try hard for me. And so that's my issue with it, just in the tone of it. But it is incredibly, stunningly, brilliantly made. Mm. You can't go wrong. And I'm interested I think they're Aryans, maybe, these blonde, blue-eyed people that are coming
in.
Yeah,
well, I feel there's possibly a more complex solution to that one. But yeah.
Right, sure. But, I didn't carry on watching. I think it's interesting that Terry and I, neither of us carried on watching it. And I think they need to focus a bit more on making it compelling, making the through line, the narrative more gripping and more compelling, and worry more about that than the spectacle, because the spectacle, they've nailed it, you know, don't get me wrong. But I don't know if I am. Like, it's not top of my list to carry on watching it, let's put it that way, at this point in time.
But I think in an hour-long, you know, program to do both spectacle, which, you know, it's essentially bookended in many respects by these two massive moments of spectacle, and then put all the character stuff, and I didn't feel underserved by the character stuff. Like, you know, the bits you did see of Vanya and a Diego and those quiet moments you're talking of, I think they made the most of those to such a degree that even I, who didn't finish watching the first season, was instantly compelled. And obviously you're learning something different about them this time, because you're not doing the stuff at this point anyway that they did in season one with the childhood, but you're seeing it's kind of an alternate life of the normality they could have experienced, and intersecting it with real life political events and all the prejudices around them and all the problems around. I don't know. I found it really, I was satisfied with the way they moved between spectacle and character. Everybody didn't get equal serving, but they don't have to, right, at that point.
Oh, sure,
I liked those, but I liked those moments of bombast, and I'm quite into that. I'm quite into the, like, let's cob everything, including the kitchen sink and next door's kitchen sink and the kitchen sink from, you know, two streets away at it, which they definitely do. I like the fact that they're not self-conscious about that. It's just kind of like a massive, big, bombastic, ridiculous, almost, like, just orgy of everything we can do, as you say, whether it's effects and it's the number of characters and it's the setup at the end is extraordinarily, like, frenetic and chaotic and big and bold. And I like that. I liked the fact that it kind of went there and wasn't too, I know you find it arch, I find it that it was not self-conscious, that it just goes, fuck it, we're just going to go for it.
I don't think this is a series that generally leans on spectacle. I think this episode is perhaps an outlier in this regard. Like, season one is not heavy on spectacle, it is very character based. There's an awful lot of violin playing in season one. You know, it's understanding these kids, how they were brought up, the kind of traumas that have come out from this upbringing they have. And obviously that's, you know, that's taken as you've already read all that stuff, you've already got all that stuff when you come into season two. But I thought this covered quite a lot of character development. Like, you see and understand a lot of where these characters are in their headspaces, how long they've been there, how it's changed them. One of them's got married, you know, they're all doing these different things because they've been here for several years, and we rejoin those characters and see how they've changed. So it's less who these characters are, it's like, who are they now? And I thought it actually did quite a good job of establishing all of that. So I thought it was, yeah, it was very bold. It was very well done.
Yes,
Umbrellas all round for The Umbrella Academy season 2, which of course drops on Netflix on Friday, July the 31st. Next up, we have Prodigal Son, which aired in the US late last year and sees Michael Sheen as a serial killer known as the Surgeon, whose son, played by Tom Payne, is a former FBI profiler who uses his family's traits to see crimes from the killer's point of view and consults with his dad. And this becomes especially helpful when a new killer emerges mimicking his father's MO. And for the record, this is 100 times more stupid than it sounds. Yeah. Isn't that right, Boyd?
Spoiler alert. Oh my fucking God. What is this show? Let me just say, first of all, talking of the kitchen sink, every single serial killer film, TV series, story you've ever heard of is referenced, I think, and it's from Science of the Lambs to Seven to Copycat to Kiss the Girls. Every single one is somehow referenced or stolen from for this series. Obviously, as you say, the main idea is like instead of Hannibal Lecter and Jodie Foster, you've got Hannibal Lecter and his son, and it's ludicrous. And not only that, his daughter, the son's, so there's Hannibal, so there's the serial killer in prison played by Michael Sheen having a great old time. He's in this prison where his cell is like a library. It's like a vast library with a TV set for some reason, and he wears a cardigan. No idea why. His son was an FBI profiler. Then he gets ditched for being crazy, and then he joins the NYPD because his mate
Lou Diamond Phillips
gets him a job there. So there's that. Then his sister is a TV news reporter who reports on serial killers and murders. Just so they're all involved. Their mum, who's barely like 5 years older than him, by the way. I mean, she doesn't know how to have these kids. Is this incredibly like? She's this like incredibly wealthy woman who has seems to live in a castle, as far as I can make out, and has the moment for Dylan chatting about serial killing. Oh, by the way, he lives in the most lavish New York loft you've ever seen. I mean, they must pay fucking well at the NYPD and the FBI, because that place is worth at least $50 million, I reckon. And he shackles himself. He has night terrors. So he shackles himself to his bed. And yet still ends up like hurtling himself out of the window at various points. Spoiler alert, there is a scene of an axe amputation, which is quite no holds barred for a network show. This is a Fox show in America, Sky One here, quite extraordinary. It is absolutely insane. And by the way, the main guy, Tom Payne, plays the main character, the profiler with that dad. And he's crazier than his dad. So Michael Sheen actually, if anything, slightly underplaying compared to Tom Payne's character, who is in absolutely bonkers. And when he has to do the amputation scene, he's like loving it. This is like a great moment for him. He's really excited about having to take an axe and amputate and take off someone's hand. It's so weird. The tone of it is almost like lighthearted hilarity, like playing for laughs. Seriously, like this is like one of the most lighthearted, frothy, fun serial killer dramas I've ever seen.
It's got like an American Psycho-y vibe to it. Like the way he's just...
Yeah, I think that's what they're trying to get
for. He's delighting in being this sort of junior sociopath, working for the good guys, but really very much in touch with his serial killer side.
Yeah, it's got a jaunty vibe, jaunty tone. And I just wasn't expecting that. So I kind of admire the fact that it's just balls to the wall crazy and tongue in cheek. There is a moment like in the first episode where we're supposed to find it a bit moving because he starts thinking about the actual ramifications of being the son of a person who murdered 23 people. At least 23 people, by the way.
At least.
And you're supposed to find that movie. I'm like, no, don't try and be moving. Don't try and move us when the rest of it is insanely frothy and fun.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know how they're going to sustain it because it's a procedural. Mm. It's so every week there's going to be a different serial killer, presumably, who he consults his dad about. I mean, are there that many serial killers, apparently, in New York State? Yeah, there has to be for this show. It is crazy. I kind of enjoyed the madness of it, but it is fucking terrible.
I enjoyed
terrible.
Michael Sheen, the way Michael Sheen does this thing where he's talking about it. He's like, yes. And he's getting really excited. But of course, it's terrible. It's terrible. Like, he's having the time of his life playing this character. It is so camp and so ridiculous. I was watching this. I was like, hang on a minute. And I was like, I can't tell whether this is genius or absolutely terrible, but it's definitely one or the other. It's very peculiar.
I mean, it's terrible. Like it's. I mean, like let's just be clear on that. And I agree with Boyd. Like you've got the Tom Payne who plays Malcolm, right? Who is fully like chaotic and crazy, and just casually unshackles himself from the bed, pops himself out of a window. Like he is meant to be the one who's kind of holding down a normalish job, even though he's looking into the exact thing that he's haunted by because his dad's a killer. It is like there are moments in the flashbacks that are so excruciating, and they're so, and like you say about American Psycho, it's like pulpy almost. And there's a moment where he's meant to be young and in college, and, you know, they obviously try and make him look like a teenager. He's playing a younger version of himself, that they just gel back his hair and put him in a Harvard jumper, even though I think he's about 45. And you're like, what is happening? They aren't nods to other things. It is literally like there's a whole setup of his cage with a library that is exactly like almost like the identical setup as Hannibal. And all I kept thinking about right during this was Anthony Hopkins. And his gorgeous, like, sick, funny, charming, creepy, his iteration of Hannibal is one of the great characters in film history. And somehow Michael Sheen is, like, too subtle in this. So he's kind of...
I know what you mean, yeah.
Like, you, I don't know if you're meant to find him scary or menacing or creepy or anything, but you don't feel any of those things. The tone is all over the chuffing shop. I mean, Christ almighty. And I kept thinking, is it meant to be so bad that it's good, or just so bad that it's bad? Or is it not meant to be either of those things and it's meant to be good? But I can't tell. But it's fucking lunacy. And as you said, the kind of basic proposition just sounds quite like tedious. And, oh, it's a procedural, because it also has the setup of a procedural as well. But it's just not. It's just like one of the weirdest things. I started watching it and I was like, what is, like, seriously, what is happening? Who is this man? What is going on? What is Michael Sheen doing in a cage? Looking a bit like an accountant. Like, I don't understand. This is mad.
It's worth noting that
there's a brilliant
Tom Payne, of course.
Sorry, there's a brilliantly baldest moment. Tom Payne's character, this genius, who's the only person in the world apparently who can identify with the serial killers and work out what their motives and obsessions are. So it works out this guy has to be bald in the middle of
it. It's the only explanation for his evilness. He must be bald.
Unbelievable.
It's worth noting that Tom Payne is, of course, Jesus from The Walking Dead, which people may not necessarily recognise without his beard and long hair. But look, I had loads of fun watching this. I mean, it's clearly rubbish, but I really enjoyed it. I mean, I'm not going to watch it because it's a procedural and I hate procedurals, but I thought Sheen was hilarious in it. He's genuinely having fun. And it's absurd. It's the kind of thing where if I were into procedurals, I think this would be right up my alley, because it's wildly over the top, huge things happening, and it's not like, you know, like the ones I used to watch, my go-to procedurals back when I used to watch them, I used to watch the CSIs, and I always liked Criminal Minds, but Criminal Minds was always very dark, like there's very little levity in Criminal Minds, whereas this deals with similar subject matters but just has tons of fun with it, and I think I've got a lot of time for that.
Yeah, I mean,
yeah,
Christ.
But I think Terry's right. I think essentially it is shit, but I will tune in again, but I'm mainly fascinated to know how they're going to make a procedure out of serial killing. They're going to have so many serial killer cases. I'm absolutely fascinated by that.
Isn't that the problem Luther has, where there's like eight different serial killers, like all?
Yeah,
there's a lot of stuff going on.
But Luther still spreads its narrative out, doesn't it, over more than multiple episodes. Whereas this is literally going to be a different case a week. It's going to be crazy. It's going to be absolutely crazy. And it's an interesting point about the Hannibal Lecter and Anthony Hopkins. I totally agree with Terry about that, because you are faced, actors must hit that. Performance was so indelible and so influential, and I feel sorry for actors having to play serial killers now, because like, what do I go down that route? I feel like Michael Sheen's almost gone down, he's playing him as a normal kind of guy having a bit of fun, and that's about it. Like, so when the kid asks him, there's a flashback to him, and he goes, why did you kill all those people, daddy? And he kind of goes, well, I don't know, like, you know, just like, I've no idea. It's like that, and that's as far as you can go. So I think that's quite an interesting choice.
Well, that is Prodigal Son, which begins on Sky on Tuesday, July the 28th at 9 p.m. Also out this week, we have a 90-minute one-off drama, not a film, written by the great Jimmy McGovern. This tells the story of Anthony Walker, a teenager murdered in a racist attack in Merseyside back in 2005. Anthony is a story of what his life could have been if things had gone differently. Terry, what did you make of this one?
I found this incredibly moving, incredibly difficult to watch at times. And that's because it is based on a real life murder, that of Anthony Walker, who was a 18-year-old boy, basically, and was murdered in a racist attack in Merseyside in 2005. But the basic premise is really interesting because, and as you say, it's Jimmy McGovern. He has had a relationship with Anthony's mother in real life for many years, and his mum's name is G. Now, she was essentially a consultant for him, and he said that she would often be his informal advisor when he was writing grieving characters. And then one day she went to him and said, "It's my turn now, and I want you to tell my son's story." And so essentially it is a mother's story. And what makes this so interesting is most dramas about an event like this, they focus on the moments before, a great deal on the attack itself, and then obviously the consequences of that, and maybe the path to justice or something. And that's the normal format we're faced with. This is fascinating because this focuses less on the literal consequences and instead of the potential life lost. And in that way, it's a fictionalized account of how Anthony Walker's life could have turned out. So it tells the story in reverse. It begins at 25 at this award ceremony, and it works back through to the moment that he was killed. And what it imagines is the children he would have had, the lives he would have changed, the woman he'd have married, the relationship he'd have continued to have with his mum. And, you know, this format is both kind of radical in one sense, but also hugely simple and powerful, because instead of trying to tell you, you know, what he was like as a boy, it showed you the man's life that was taken as well, the man he would have become in society, in his family. I found it incredibly, incredibly moving. And it was based on interviews with Anthony's mom and sisters and family members to create the portrait of this young man and what his life would have gone on to be. Anthony is played by Toheeb Jimmo, who is kind of relatively a newcomer, but he's also going to be in The Power, Amazon's adaptation of the Naomi Alderman novel. He is wonderful as Anthony. So you get the sense of his mischief, his charm, all the different sides of his character. You kind of see him changing into this man. If he hadn't been so brutally murdered, he puts in an incredible performance, as does, and I have to say, Raki Aola as his mum. She is the real heart of this. And, you know, I keep saying it, but this is a mother's story of what she has lost by losing her son as well. I just found this incredible. And it does, as you get towards the moment of the attack and when he was murdered, that is so difficult to watch because you've just watched the life that's been robbed from him, and you know what's at stake, and you know what that family and society has been robbed of. And it makes that moment so difficult to sit through. I was in tears for the last pretty much 35 minutes of this. I just think it's incredible. I think Jimmy McGovern's just come up with this incredible way of telling this story in a completely different way than most real life murders are portrayed on screen. I think the relationship with his mum is clear, and how it's given a real intimacy to the portrait of this young man. And there are big events, you know, the child he would have gone on to have, but also these beautiful little family sketches, these moments they spend together, which shows the kind of normality an intimacy of small moments that were lost alongside these big life events. I think this is a brilliant, brilliant piece of television, and everybody should watch it.
Yeah, I did find it almost unbearable to watch at various moments, because it just, the whole idea of it is so, as an idea, it's incredibly moving to kind of commemorate a life that was cruelly cut short in this way. Is so, it's kind of inherently, you're kind of making real this person, you just know the name and you know the incident and you know how he was horrendously murdered, and then to turn that into an artwork which commemorates his life in such a kind of subtle way is such a brilliant way of doing it. And it reminded me a bit of The episode of Cucumber Russell T. Davis' series, episode 6, famous, one of the best single episodes of TV drama of the last 10, 15 years, which told the story of the fictional character of Lance, who's of his life, and it kind of from beginning to end. And then he's tragically killed at the end of that episode. And just the way it kind of showing incidents in someone's life, in this case, this real human being, it's just over almost overwhelming, as you say. And again, and I didn't know, so I'd read about it, and I knew that this brilliant idea of telling the incidents from his life was how it was going to be done, but I didn't know how it was going to deal with the actual incident, the racist murder itself. And that, as you say, oh my god, it's so chilling to the bone. And the aftermath, the mother talking, the scene with the mother and the nurse, I think was so incredible. Yeah, it's as you say, it has to be seen. But it is really, really, it's painful, and yet at the same time, you have to watch it.
I have not seen this, and frankly, it sounds soul-crushingly depressing, so I may not watch it, but it does sound very good. Either way, Anzi does drop on BBC One on Monday, July the 27th at 8:30 p.m. Finally, on a slightly lighter note, we have the triumphant return of the Muppets. Muppets Now arrives this week on Disney Plus and brings the gang back together for a kind of improvisational comedy show. And this one, it's got RuPaul, Taye Diggs, Linda Cardellini, even Danny Trejo turns up to talk to Piggy and the crew. Boyd, did you sanction this buffoonery?
Well, when you said triumphant return, I almost went,
is it though?
I was really looking forward to this. I'm a huge Muppet fan. I'm very much pro Muppet. You know, I was brought up watching the Muppet Show in the late 70s on ITV. I loved it. It was such a great format. You know, they'd have a guest host each week. It was kind of like the Muppet Show, the original Muppet Show, was a bit like Saturday Night Live kind of format in a way. It was like the making of this variety entertainment show, and it was fantastic. And I loved some of the films. I even liked the reboot, fairly recent reboot. And what I was hoping, because the way this has been publicized by Disney Plus is that it's like an improvised sitcom. Mm. Right. And I was like, how's that work? How do you improvise with the puppetry, etc.? And so I was expecting it almost to be their take on like a Curb Your Enthusiasm Extras type of thing, where them and to begin with, you think that's almost what it is. So the setup is that they're creating this show. They're creating kind of elements of a YouTube style show where they're Miss Pig is like an influencer, and she wants to kind of get free stuff on the internet, which is quite a funny idea. Kermit wants to interview people, celebrities, so he interviews RuPaul in it and gets interrupted a lot. So there's like segments of a show which all kind of spoof different TV or particularly streaming and YouTube genres, and the idea is that it's all being edited at the last minute, and the Muppet that's editing it all together is constantly Scooter is it being interrupted and everything. And there's sequences where they all chip in on different. And I was working out, I can work out with this must have been made before lockdown, and yet some of it feels like it's been made.
It feels like a mix of, because part of it feels like they're distant, like sort of remote interviews, and then there's a bunch of puppets all in a room, presumably not all being operated by the same person. So yeah, I was baffled by that.
It is baffling. It is confusing. But you know what the problem is? It just isn't funny enough. It's not funny enough. So there's the odd moment that's kind of mildly amusing. As I say, Miss Piggy being an influencer is quite funny. You know, there's the odd moment. Kermit popping up behind people's photos is quite amusing. Photo bombing. By the way, Chris Hewitt mentioned in last week's Empire podcast that the voice of Kermit has gone wrong. And I absolutely agree. That whoever's fucking voicing Kermit, it doesn't sound anything like the original Kermit. And that's a huge problem for me. It's really irritating. It's really annoying. Because Kermit was such an identifiable voice. It's all about that voice and that character. Now it's just like a blur. Who cares? And so I was really disappointed. It's not that funny. It's like overly contrived for a show that's, and what's improvised clearly is, so when Kermit interviews RuPaul is clearly improvising. And so, but what, in a way that backfires because they're not given funny enough material to bounce off the Muppet characters in it. So I was really disappointed.
I'm with you. I mean, I'm not pro Muppet. I'm not necessarily anti Muppet, but the Muppets fail my Belen test. Like, I don't like any of them.
God, the Muppets do.
Wow.
I've not got a lot of affection or love for the Muppets. If I'm honest with you, I'd take the Sesame Street gang any day of the week. But and I think the problem with this is it was really just all over the place, very hit and miss. It's not sort of properly scripted, so it isn't particularly funny, and I wasn't quite sure what they were trying to do with it. It also doesn't help that Scooter is my least favorite Muppet, and he's the first one who's on screen. But I didn't find it amusing. I kind of felt for Taye Diggs and Linda Cardellini, and they're all very game, as I think the best guests on Muppets are, but they just don't have an awful lot to work with. Also, and I have to say this, I fucking hate Miss Piggy. Like, she's so deeply, fundamentally irritating that I just...
Hang on. We began this podcast with you saying I was just like Miss Piggy.
I mean, look, paging Dr. Yeah. Freud.
Wow. And you've just said, I fucking hate her. She's so fucking irritating.
That is brilliant.
Yeah, so, quote-unquote, Miss Piggy is not my thing. I just, she drives me nuts. I didn't like any of them. If this had been so Muppets Most Wanted and the two most recent movies at least had the benefit of good screenwriting. Do you know what I mean? They had good material in there. And I think it gets past the Muppets, you know, inherent bellendery to give you an interesting, fun story. And I think without that structure and without that kind of quality screenwriting here, you just end up with irritating puppets being irritating. And that, for me, is what Muppets Now is. But I'm not the target audience, let's be honest.
You're not wrong.
It's probably worth mentioning. Kind of aimed at kids. And you've got to think that they'll probably enjoy it slightly more because it is anarchic and it is stupid. Well, but a lot of stuff they reference, I guess, they're casting that quite wide, isn't it? So that they're entertaining for all ages.
Yeah, you say, of course, it's partly aimed at kids, but I think actually the whole point of the Muppets right from the start was that it was going to be very entertaining for adults as well. That's the kind of one of the key elements of it. And all the references in this, you know, I think the whole way it's done is meant to appeal to adults as well, but it does not.
or at least did not in this case. Boyd and I say no to the Muppets. Where does this drop? This drops on Disney Plus when, Boyd?
On Friday.
This drops Friday, yeah. The Muppets Friday, are not available now, but they are available on Disney Plus on Friday, which would have been a more cumbersome title for the show. So, pick of the week, people. Terry's still not talking to me after my Miss Piggy polemic.
So the woman who / character you fucking hate and find really fucking irritating, my pick would be Anthony. Thank you.
Anthony's Head and Shoulders. Yeah, yes. It's like, wow.
I didn't see Anthony. Sorry. So for me, it's the Umbrella Academy. So make of that what you will.
And I would also put in a vote for Dummy for the actual show, if not for the platform.
Yes. If you get a chance to Queeby, that does seem to me like it's the pick of that lot. But yeah, Most Dangerous Game you can probably skip. Right, shall we go out with a bang, or specifically with a banshee? The Banshee segment, named, of course, after the Jonathan Tropper show, Banshee, where we take an old show and recommend it for our listeners. Who would like to dust something off from the archives first?
I will.
I can. Oh, there you go.
Okay. So I want to Banshee Champions, which was an NBC comedy from 2018. It was kind of meant to be, or people were putting it in the same ilk as The Good Place, but it only lasted one season. Hardly anyone remembers it. But I actually watched a few episodes on Netflix and I really enjoyed it. So this was created by Charlie Grandy and Mindy Kaling, who'd previously worked together on The Office and on Mindy Kaling's, what do you call it?
The Mindy Project.
Mindy Project. He worked together on The Office and on The Mindy Project.
Did you just call it The Mindy Project?
You did say Mingy. You did say
The Mingy Project.
Did I say Mingy?
You did. You definitely said Mingy. Yeah.
This is going in the outtakes.
Oh, yeah. Oh, God. Okay. Charlie Grandy and Mindy Kaling, who worked together on The Office and The Mindy Project.
You destroyed me.
The basic premise of this is it stars Anders Holm, who's a guy who owns a gym in Brooklyn, and essentially one day out of the blue turns up Priya, played by Mindy Kaling, who basically drops off his 15-year-old son, who went, either he was, can't remember if she was pregnant or he was a toddler, they agreed that he wouldn't be part of his life, but basically finds himself in New York with nowhere to live. And suddenly, this guy who'd been a bit of a kind of bachelor guy about town, gym owner guy in Brooklyn, has a 15-year-old son to contend with, that's been dropped off overnight. So I thought this was actually really quite funny. As you'd probably expect, it's about them kind of their years of estrangement, getting over that, and how this guy's life is transformed overnight and their changing dynamic and relationship. But I thought this was very sweet at times. The performances were good, and I thought it was funnier than people gave it credit for, is what I would say. The entire season one is on the Netflix, I believe, if you want to watch it. Mindy Project.
The Mindy Project, yes.
The Mindy Project.
What was the show called? The actual show?
Champions.
Okay, good. I'm going to jump in here with mine. I'm going to do this very, very quickly. But this was recommended to me by someone on Twitter, and I realised that I had in fact seen it. Specifically, I went on holiday to Bali once, and instead of enjoying the holiday, I spent the entire time watching this miniseries, just sitting in a room watching John Adams, HBO's John Adams, which starred Paul Giamatti as one of the founding fathers as John Adams, in this sort of seven part show, which ran. It was 2008, I believe it dropped, but. What got me thinking about this was Hamilton, and I think someone originally had said, look, it's the actual West Wing, like, but the original West Wing. I was like, sold, I'll watch it. I really like this mainly because it's a period of history, like American history, I didn't know an awful lot about. It's the founding of the nation, and it's sort of the first 50 years of the United States. But what makes this stand out really for me was Giamatti as John Adams and Laura Linney as his wife in this. There's loads of other good people in it. Stephen Delane's in it, Tom Wilkinson, David Morse, Danny Houston, Rufus Sewell, Justin Theroux in it as well. Really, really great people. But it's a sort of lavish looking period piece. Funnily enough, I remember at the time it got quite criticized for the casting. Like, people didn't buy Giamatti as John Adams, which I find extraordinary. Like, maybe they just didn't like him as a leading man, but you know how good Giamatti is, and he is fantastic in this role. He really carries it. It's a sort of powerhouse performance. But yeah, if you are interested in American politics, if you want to hear a little bit more about the founding fathers, or sort of a bit of Hamilton without the rapping, then maybe give John Adams a go. I'm sure it is available somewhere.
Yeah, it was good.
There you go. That's boys like, yeah, that's all right. It's all right.
It's good, yeah. I've stolen mine a little bit. Well, I've got a two-part Banshee this week, and part one of it is stolen from Nick Desemlian on esteemed acting editor, is he, of Empire magazine, whilst someone's on maternity leave. He tweeted about Garth Marenghi's Dark Place and reminded me of the absolute brilliance of this show that only lasted one series back in 2004, created by Richard Ayoade, who's hosting the BAFTAs later this week, and Matthew Holness. And the whole conceit of it was that Matthew Holness's character, Garth Marenghi, was a horror author, an ultra-nerdy horror author of kind of James Herbert-type horror books, and that there was a kind of a filmed TV version of it in the 80s that was never aired, and that this is, and so he would introduce episodes of this incredibly badly made, absolutely hilarious versions of adaptations of his books. So that was Garth Marenghi's Dark Place. It's absolutely brilliantly funny all the way through. Matt Berry's in it, Alice Lowe's in it, Matthew Holness himself. So that's part one of it. But part two of it that Nick didn't mention on Twitter was the kind of follow-up sequel series. So that only lasted one series. Man to Man with Dean Lerner arrived in 2006, about 18 months later, also created by the same people. And this was, Dean Lerner was the publisher of Garth Marenghi's books, if you like, played by Richard Ayoade. And this was a chat show, a late night chat show, in which Dean Lerner, played by Richard Ayoade, interviewed a different person each week, all of them played by Matthew Holness, and starting with Garth Marenghi himself, and then going on to Steve Pissing, who was a Formula 5 motor racing world champion, who was a lot like Nigel Mansell, Glyn Nimron, who was like a kind of actor in shows like Star Trek and Red Dwarf and things like that, and Merriman Weir, who was a folk guitarist, etc., etc., and they were all absolutely absolutely hilarious. And the detail of these half-hour one-on-one interviews, spoof interviews, were extraordinary. It's almost unbelievable they ever got commissioned, I have to say, because it was, on the one hand, incredibly self-indulgent in a way, but brilliantly done and hilariously funny if you like that stuff. So man-to-man with Dean Lowe. Now, I know you can get Garth Marenghi is on all four now, all the episodes. And if anyone has not seen it, they are absolutely fucking brilliant. Man-to-man with Dean Lowe is not widely available, but you can get on DVD for a few quid on Amazon.
We were talking about quoting earlier, Chris Hewitt and Nick Desamlian quote Garth Marenghi. That's a show I'd watch. They quote Garth Marenghi's Dark Place endlessly, and it drives me insane because I did watch an episode of that at their behest, and you will be unsurprised to hear I hated every single second of it. So, yeah.
Don't let that put you off.
Yes, Garth Marenghi's Garth Place. That's what I want to see.
Yeah.
Well, I guess that's it for another episode of the Pilot TV Podcast. We are, as ever, receptive to your 5-star Apple Podcast reviews, even if they end up being like Harrogate Pablo's terribly polite 1-star review, which simply read, "Not for me. Everyone moans about everything these days, and it's not helping. This wasn't for me, but they're trying their best." Thanks, Pablo. That's very genteel. But a 2-star would have fucking killed you. I mean, honestly. We're all on social media at James C. Dyer, at Terry_White, and at Boyd Hilton, as well as the show itself at Pilot TV Pod. Myself, Boyd, and soon-to-be television legend Terry White will be back in your ears next Monday with another show, though what will be on that show is, at this point, a mystery. Perhaps Deadline has the exclusive on that one. We'll head over there now and check. Pilot out.